Does it strike anyone else as kind of suspicious how every single winner of the Miss Universe pageant has been from the planet Earth? Like, I don't even think that crown has left our atmosphere. That doesn't seem fair.
Seems pretty rigged to me, so consider this my application to be a more galactic Miss Universe.
Launch sequence activated.
This is my crown. You may notice it's not on my head where Miss America probably intended for it to live when they gave it to me, and that's because I yeeted it to space. But to understand how it got there, let's rewind a few years. Okay, so the abbreviated version is basically one night in college, I was hanging out with some friends, and we ended up watching the John Oliver skit on Miss America, which, if you haven't seen, is hysterical and also very spot on.
And just a reminder to those of you at home, it is the year 2014, and I am a fully clothed man standing in front of a line of women in swimsuits awaiting judgment. Beautiful.
The rest of the skit pretty much goes on to talk about how over the last 10 years, Miss America has completely rebranded to say that they're not a beauty pageant, they're a scholarship fund.
It is not a beauty pageant, it is a scholarship program.
And their mission is to fund the college educations of the next generation of doctors, lawyers, CEOs, and engineers. And at the time, I was not only an award-winning robotics engineer, but also the CEO of a tech startup that had just raised hundreds of thousands of dollars in pre-seed funding. And so me and my friends thought it'd be funny to see if Miss America puts their money where their mouth is. Are they actually looking for the girl with the best resume, or is it still just a beauty pageant?
Absolutely not.
So we went all Miss Congeniality on them and infiltrated the system.
Our physical fitness in swimsuit winner is Xyla Foxlin.
Told you she had the nice boots.
Our talent winner is Xyla Foxlin. Our new Miss Greater Cleveland and winner of a $500 scholarship is Xyla Foxlin.
Xyla and a tiara is something that we are not going to see every day. Everybody.
Oh, there she is.
And then as a winner of a local pageant, I went on to compete at Miss Ohio, where I learned that pageantry is a learned skill and I was way out of my depth. Luckily though, I didn't really have any huge aspirations of actually going to Miss America, so I used the week to make friends, have fun, and also make a statement. I wore my mom's wedding cheapaw as my evening gown, which the judges and some of the racist people hated, and I also built a musical Tesla coil as both my senior thesis project for my engineering degree, as well as my Miss Ohio talent, which I found out spurred the Miss Ohio director to remind the judges not to be impressed by loud props, and I count that as a win. But if this middle school gal and her friends were inspired enough to send me this note, I say it was worth it. And this is the part that I have filmed and rethought about so many times over the last 4 to 5 months. I really wanted to be able to take a stand and say pageants are good or pageants are bad, but it's super blurry. And after a lot of conversations with friends and family, I think I've come to the conclusion that the people are good and the system is really bad. Except that I feel like by bashing the system, I'm bashing the people, but I'm not. They're completely separate, and I wanna make that very, very clear. The volunteers that make Miss Ohio happen are genuinely some of the kindest, best, hardworking people that I know, and the girls I competed with are now some of my best friends. But it doesn't mean that the system isn't incredibly broken and we should throw it away or send it to the stratosphere or whatever. My experiences at Miss Ohio were really, really complicated. Not only was I the only non-white contestant, but there has never been a Miss Ohio of any kind of color in its 100-year history. And it's so easy to take this like elitist route of saying, you know, I am better than that, that's a relic of the 1950s, which it is. But also remember that if you're a girl in rural small town Ohio, it could also be viewed as your way out. And so what better way to celebrate my experience than to send the ultimate symbol of pageantry into the stratosphere as far away from all of us as possible. Let's do it. This, by the way, is Joseph Madel. He's a former flight controller for the International Space Station, that's right, the actual ISS, who was so awestruck by the footage he was seeing of the Earth rolling by below, he made it his life mission to share that with as many people as possible. And that's why he founded High Altitude Science. And by the way, I spent months researching how to launch a weather balloon in a student-accessible way before choosing and reaching out to High Altitude Science specifically to sponsor this video. So, yes, they provided product, but they're not paying me. This little ad is because I genuinely could not recommend their kits and flight computers more highly to parents, teachers, and general space enthusiasts. If you're looking for a socially distant COVID science lab activity, I'm just saying, not much is more magical than launching something of your own into the stratosphere. We're using helium to give this space balloon its lift, so I rented this industrial-sized tank and connected the High Altitude Science weather balloon inflator to it. We used a flow meter to precisely control exactly how much helium could enter the balloon, but most people do this by measuring the force of the balloon's lift. And with that set up, it was time to unbox the balloon. This is a 1200 gram balloon, which is a little ambitious for a first timer, but necessary considering we had two scientific payloads daisy chained, totaling to just shy of 4 pounds. With the balloon still in the bag, I inserted the nozzle into the balloon and made sure it was snug before unwrapping the rest of it. You'll notice the rubber bands for tying it off are already on my wrist so that I don't have to find them later when I have a balloon that's like pulling me into the sky. I've also removed all of my jewelry and rings for this, as any damage to the balloon can cause it to burst too early. Then it's just a matter of inflating the balloon and making sure it doesn't touch the ground or get tangled up on you, which is a harder task than it sounds on a windy day like today.
Okay, so at this point it is lifting itself. I'm just providing it pats of reassurance. So we're now watching the flow meter, waiting for it to hit 4360, and then we're gonna shut it off.
To be honest, I was too nervous about letting this go to get any good footage of tying it off, but there's plenty of great information on the High Altitude Science website, which I've linked down below.
I now have a balloon. This is generating about 5 pounds of lift, so I'm not working all that hard, although I'm working really hard in my brain because I know if I let this go, we don't have enough helium to fill another one.
All right. Xyla, are you ready?
Yes. Born ready.
The last thing to do was to turn all the electronics in the payload on and make sure all the cameras are running.
Running.
Okay, and then this one?
Running.
Okay.
That, unfortunately for our ears, includes turning the audio beacon on, which will help us find it if it lands in a cornfield or a soybean field. It's really hard to portray in video how exciting and terrifying and enthralling it is to track a payload to the stratosphere and back.
What are we at?
It's about an update.
I want to see it right now. I want it to live stream back down to me.
94. 94. 94 100. Just
here's a...
That's probably a good parking lot here.
At this point, we were pretty much driving in circles under where we were getting pings from the APRS transmitter, just waiting for the balloon to burst and fall back down. We knew it would travel a little bit once it hit the jet stream again on the way back down, so we just found a parking lot and camped out for a little while.
I'll be so excited for you if we break 100,000 feet.
Me too!
Because it's like the it's borderline performance for this balloon with this much payload. 99102!
Ah!
Okay, so we're about to find out if we've made 100,000 feet. We're so close. We're at like 99.
102.
102.
That was the signal. Let's wait for the website to
what
update.
What do we get? What do we get? 100,000 feet is our goal here.
100,096.
Yes! We made it! It's gotta be a Guinness World Record. Like, no one else has launched a crown into near space.
No.
No way. We're at 111,000 feet.
That's crazy.
111. Lucky number, make a wish.
112,000.
What?
We might make it 115.
On board, we had an APRS transmitter and a GPS. And that double redundancy is gonna save us.
Showing last scene 14 minutes ago.
Yeah, that's what I'm seeing too.
Okay.
When the balloon burst at 112,000 feet, we actually lost contact with it for about 30 to 45 minutes because at burst, and we didn't know this at the time, the scientific payload collided with the APRS transmitter, destroying it. And so we just lost contact. And I wish I could tell you or explain to you how terrifying that is, because you're tracking this thing all the way up into space. And not only that, but we had Instagram lived the whole thing. So all of my followers are also tracking this balloon into space, and then poof, no signal, nothing. Until we finally got a beep from our GPS spot trace, which was our backup locator, and that let us know where it landed. But, oh, scary, so scary.
So we are now 5 minutes away from what we think is the ping of the landing site.
Oh, I think it's in this field here. Okay, they're home, so we'll have to probably talk to them.
Yeah.
And I feel like this house on the left is the best guess. So we'll just put on a nice big smile.
Yeah.
We chatted with the really nice family in the farmhouse on the property and got permission to go tramping through their soybean fields to retrieve our payloads. Luckily, there were cattle paths through the soybean fields, so we actually didn't end up doing all that much damage to the crop. Oh my god, I hear it!
Maybe the crown camera could tell you what happened.
Beacon was certainly very helpful. There was no tree climbing required, and I'm just really excited to pull the data off of this and to get all the video and see what we have. And so without further ado, please enjoy my crown's space odyssey. You're a lonely sailor, and your soul is made of wind and rain, doubts and blame. I'm a weary pirate, and my heart is made of dust and grain, and spoiled champagne. I've got troubles, I've got sins, I'm my worst enemy. But I've still got a lot to give. So I said, hey, don't you wanna come? Come and run away with me. Hey, won't you come? Won't you come and
say by chance, don't you want a man? A man who fully understands a sailor's heart, a sailor's heart.
And for my fellow graph nerds, here's a nice MATLAB plot of all of my data. And to take the nerdiness one step further, we did some math and determined a handful of cornfields that the crown landed in. For some reason, NASA hasn't tested the terminal velocity of a Miss America crown yet, but based on some estimations, we know it's somewhere in southern Sherman Township in Ohio.
I have a couple more weather balloon ideas. If you thought that was fun, please let me know in the comments. And share this video with all your friends so that I can justify the budget to do another one. Ooh, if you would like to win your own sash, lucky for you, Amazon blank sashes come in packs of four. I'm gonna be giving away the space crown and this sash that I'm wearing right now on my Patreon, so feel free to join my Patreon if you'd like a chance to win it. That would be your highest likelihood. And then I'll give one away on Instagram and one away on Twitter. So all you'll have to do is respond to the question I ask on my post with this picture, and you'll get entered into the drawing. Also, on my Patreon, I finally got my shit together and I started doing monthly Zoom hangs. And so if you'd like to hang out with me on Zoom, I would love to have you there. So please consider joining my Patreon. I would really appreciate it. And follow me on this. I never got good at this thing. That's just... Ugh, that sash is such a weird tradition.